Welcome back to the room where it happened. I guess it's okay to say welcome back. We've now have a couple of episodes, so we actually are coming back. Hopefully you've listened to a few before, and we're glad that you're back today. This is Don sitting in the host chair for the room where it happened, but I am not alone today. Unlike A Fork in Time, our other podcast, we don't have the magical what-if machine. We have the what-did and let's talk about it machine, and today I'm joined by Chris Coppola, Eric Rush, and Brody Burton. So glad to have all of you guys joining us here today. So I'll let you just say hi really quick so people can get accustomed to your voices, and then we'll launch off into what is room number two of the room where it happened. Chris, you want to go first since I see you in my upper left?
Hi, really quick so you can get accustomed to my voice. This is Chris. If you listen, I mean, you're pretty familiar with me.
Yeah. And then Eric, you're to my lower left.
Yeah. Hi, Don. Hi, Chris. Hi, Brody. We're back for more. Excited about the topic today.
Me too. And then finally, we have Brody joining us. Brody, you're in my lower right. You're last here, but certainly not least.
Hello.
Can you hear us, Brody?
Hello, everyone. I can hear everyone.
All right. Good
hello,
deal.
Don. Hello, Chris. Hello, Eric.
Hey.
And for those of you who may not be listeners to A Fork in Time, by the way, that's not okay. You need to rectify that immediately. But for those of you that aren't, Brody has joined us a couple of times there on the podcast and has his own podcast that's also about alternate history, which is Imagine If. So I would encourage you to go check out Imagine if you get a chance. But this is not an alternate history podcast, the room where it happened. This is an actual history podcast where we get to talk about real things, and we may look at some what ifs as part of the exploration, but that's not the purpose here. And today's topic, as we've talked about, the concept of the room where it happened is to focus on like a geographic location, the room that's representative of something, then flow off of that. So the room today is, it's a room. It's actually an interesting thing to talk about because we're not even sure which room it might have been in the house. If we will, when we get into that, we may talk a little bit about what's the real and what's the myth here. But it's also, I think, mythical for other reasons potentially as well in terms of how stories get told in American business and how we tend to focus on things. But our topic today is going to be, it's a little bitty, it's a garage in Los Altos, California. And it's sort of well known for being the birthplace, so to speak, of a computer company. Perhaps you've heard of them. They've been around for a while now, been around since the mid-70s, and that's Apple Computers. So we're talking about the mythical garage that's the founding place where a couple of guys named Steve Jobs and Wozniak founded a little company called Apple Computers. Now, the truth of the matter is, the more I dig into this, there's debate over this. Yes, they were at some point probably doing stuff in the garage. I guess it's actually Steve's parents' home. It's not even his home. Steve's like all of whatever he is at this point. I guess he's all of in his early 20s at this point. He must be like 21, 22 in 76. They're both about to drop out of college. Wozniak's a little bit older, but probably actually began in the bedroom there. Probably Steve's bedroom is where the company really got founded. And they had to move into the garage, do a little production work. But whatever the case is, everything I read is they didn't stay there for long. They pretty much had their own business space that they had to get pretty quickly. So this is a little bit of a apocryphal story in some ways about the founding of Apple Computers, but it makes a nice story. You know, American company founded in a garage, Silicon Valley, the whole myth of Silicon Valley, which I'm sure we'll probably get into today to some degree, because there's a lot of American culture in my mind that's weaved in with this story. It's a little bit like a Forrest Gump approach to understanding computers too. It's like, you know, told through the story of this one guy and his journey through the process is almost what you can look at there.
The other thing that just comes to mind, the whole garage, the whole California garage thing, it sounds like the Beach Boys or CCR, or it sounds like one of those bands that started in a garage and then hit it big. I think, you know, and I know that Jobs was kind of into the countercultural thing. So that kind of fits in with that whole image of,
Well, and not only that, but I think we're going to see how that myth and or reality, because Jobs is one of the most interesting characters, whether you like him or hate him, to me, he's one of the most interesting characters in American business in the last, it's been, 45 years, I guess, if you want to look at it from that perspective. And the shadow that he cast, and, you know, he has fans, he has detractors, you know, all the things that are there. In fact, what I was going to say is, you know, we could talk about Democrats versus Republicans. We could talk red versus blue. So we were talking off podcast, you know, we were talking about hatred and love for certain sports teams. You know, we tend to look at the world through very binary eyes. I think that's just the way we're sort of wired. We root for, we root against. One of the things I often say about myself when it comes to my sports rooting is I'm actually sometimes more passionate about the teams that I root against than the teams that I actually root for. For example, I've often said, you know, Satan and his minions could be playing the Yankees. And if the Satans hit a homer, I'm probably going to cheer. You know, that's just the way I'm wired. But, you know, I think one of the most interesting sort of, I'll call it subtle divides in American culture, world culture, I guess, when it comes to computers and technology, there is this divide that is Apple and everyone else that still sort of exists to today. And it goes back a pretty good ways. This is not new. It manifests itself today primarily in the smartphone space with iPhones versus Android devices. But, you know, it goes back to music players. It goes back to computers. It just goes back. And so, yeah, I think it's interesting. You know, I mentioned this off podcast, you know, you grew up with a certain generation like I did. You know, I can ask a guy, you know, Ginger or Marianne, and that will tell me a lot about his personality, if that even makes sense or a reference to a lot of folks. I can ask somebody pretty quickly, iOS or Android, and I learn a lot about them just by the answer to that question. And so I think we're going to explore that today. I see nodding heads on my screen, which gets me very excited for where we're about to go. And for those of you, you will see this, it'll probably be the image that's posted on the website along with the episode. What is sitting behind Chris, I will just describe as two popular cultural icons that have been merged. I'm going to leave it at that.
Interestingly enough, the other thing I'm thinking about, both of these cultural icons definitely fit into what you were saying about a binary divide.
Right.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we tend to be for or against things, you know, pretty directly. So when you see that image, you'll know what I'm talking about. I'll just allude to it now to encourage you to check out what's there on at www.aforkintimepodcast.com is still where we host both parts. So I'm going to, before we get to the break here, as we're setting up the story, sort of the background, we don't want to spend too much time doing that so we can get into the actual discussion. Is there anything about the garage part of the story, Chris, Eric, Brody, that really stands out at you guys that we know we'll probably be referencing it, so maybe we should mention it now before we get down into the nitty-gritty of how all this has played out over time?
Yeah, I think about this in terms of what Chris had mentioned about Steve Jobs. Is he kind of pulls from sort of that Americana California ethos a little bit. To really put the narrative of, you know, just two hardworking kids who are putting together a computer in a garage. And this is one of the things about Steve Jobs that I've always found the most fascinating is, again, if whether you like him or whether you don't, he really managed to leverage his image very well. And we really, I think, didn't see as much about the real Steve Jobs in public until after he had died. And then we're starting to learn a little bit more.
And when I hear those stories, Eric, I agree with that. When I hear those stories, they surprise me in different ways because mm-hmm. I hear about this guy, you know, who in some ways was a tyrannical boss apparently to work for. But then you also hear about this passion for excellence at the same time that's melded in with that. And how do you balance those two things? I mean, brilliance tends to come in multiple flavors derived from the same source there in my mind. And I agree. We've learned more about him. I've learned more. You know, I think he mellowed over time in some ways. Perhaps, you know, we've heard the stories about his later life versus his early life. But I think he's a fantastic persona. He's a real person. He's not a character. But to your point, I think at times he was a character in terms of what was portrayed publicly. And so trying to figure out the real guy versus, you know, the character, which I guess is true for all of us, is an interesting part of that. But I think you guys are right. There's something about that working hard. And by the way, the first things that they built together were boxes, but they weren't computers. They were ways to scam long distance phone calling. The famous blue boxes. That was the first thing the two Steves put together and were selling. So that's a whole different ethos, which is, you know, taking on, if you will. That was still also something that will come up later, I'm sure. That was in some ways taking on the establishment, taking on the man, you know, getting around the long distance monopoly that AT&T represented at the time in 1971.
And to fast forward a little bit to the 1984 Super Bowl commercial.
Exactly. That's what I have in my head. But that's exactly what I have in my head. I know we're going to talk about that because to me, that's one of the iconic markers there. So what we'll ask you guys to do, if you're listening, is stick with us. We're going to have a quick break here. When we come back, we're going to launch off into just a discussion about Apple computers and its influence on things. So hope you join us when we come back.
Alexis and Don here, taking just a quick break from the podcast today to actually talk about the technology that we're using to bring you the podcast. We're going to talk about Buzzsprout, which is where we host A Fork in Time. Now, you may get our podcast via a number of the other podcatchers, the other ways that podcasts are syndicated. So you might be listening on Apple Podcasts, you might be listening on Google Podcasts, you might be listening on Stitcher. But Alexis, where do we post the podcast at?
On Buzzsprout.
On Buzzsprout. When we started A Fork in Time, I got to be honest with you, I guess I'd read a few things. I was familiar with a couple of different podcast hosting sites because I'd heard their names being a podcast listener, but I had no idea what was really going to be involved with setting up a podcast. And I can tell you, it's actually pretty easy. Wouldn't you agree, Alexis?
Yes.
And the reason it's pretty easy is that Buzzsprout's there to help you through every part of the process. And so what Buzzsprout is they're not just a hosting service, but they give you suggestions, and they're a platform that really helps podcasts of any size be able to get their word out. In fact, so much so that over 100,000 podcasts actually call Buzzsprout home.
Yep.
And so what we have for our listeners is an opportunity to help support the podcast and also utilize Buzzsprout services. So all you have to do is follow the link in the show notes. And if you do, because you're looking to start a podcast, they'll walk you through, believe me, they'll walk you through very easily on the website what you need to do. And if you choose to move forward there, we actually get a benefit from that. So I think I would call that, what's the word that we use for that, Alexis?
Win-win.
Win-win is the word that we use for that. And again, some of the things that I've already mentioned is we use Buzzsprout. We find it very easy to use. Uploading an episode each week, I think, is
super simple. And they even send you stats every week, which get a little addicting to look at.
I agree with that. In fact, that's another interesting thing that I didn't even, I guess, fully realize as we were starting, that immediately we'd be able to start seeing stats, not only about how many downloads, how many listens, but where in the world people are listening, all of that kind of thing. So it's not just a place to host a podcast. It's really the full support that's there. There's other affiliations that they have that allow either a novice podcaster or an experienced podcaster to get the podcast up and growing. So we don't consider anyone starting a podcast to be a competitor because we're all in this space together. So if you've been thinking about starting a podcast, what would you recommend our listeners do, Lex?
Go to Buzzsprout. It's a good starting point.
I would agree. And so all you need to do is follow the link in our show notes and go there and you'll see what's available for you. So we'd encourage you to do that. So Buzzsprout, it's the home of A Fork in Time, and it could be home of your podcast as well.
Thanks for sticking with us and welcome back to the room where it happened. Joined by Chris, Eric, and Brody today. And we're talking about room number two. Room number two being the garage in Los Altos, California, where the legendary Apple computer was born with a couple of guys named Steve and technology on the forefront in 1976. So first of all, I'm going to have everybody declare where you are, because we talked about in the intro, you are either probably moderately or soundly pro-Apple, or you are moderately or soundly some form of anti-Apple. So now's the time to stake your claim. Chris, I have a pretty good idea where you stand. You're in my upper left, so I'm going to start with you.
And this is going to kind of date myself, kind of where I fit into this. I have a real job, so I'm pro-Windows Android. I'm not some freaking hippie. Never mind. Okay. There's plenty of time for that.
Yeah, and there will be. Yeah, I when we were talking actually off podcast for the other podcast, Chris and I were talking about this the other day, and I had no doubt where Chris was coming from. I'll just leave it at that, and you won't either when we're done here. Eric, where do you stand? Where do you stand on the important question of the day?
I'm going to call myself moderately anti-Apple. I am coming to you on a Hewlett-Packard desktop. I have Hewlett-Packard laptops. I have an Android, or this is a Samsung S9 that I use for a phone. But my kids have Apple products because they like them. That's why I'm moderately and not totally anti-Apple. So we do have a couple of iPods iPads for entertainment purposes that my kids like to use. But
okay.
So it's moderately anti-Apple.
Fair enough. Brody, where do you fall on the question?
Not sure if I should answer given the anti-Apple stance of the room.
Somebody's got to stand for Apple. I'm going to have to be the proxy if no one else will. So
I'm moderately pro-Apple. I'm coming on a Google Chromebook because MacBooks suck.
That is correct.
I use iPhone for smartphone. Kind of am a little upset. My other iPhone broke like 3 days ago, so I'm using an old iPhone 5 and realizing how useless this thing was.
And the fact that that is now eight generations ago, you know, I have to stop and do the math on where we are now. I guess we're on the 12, but because I get confused with the device versus the iOS version because they're not in sync now anymore. So, okay. So Brody, I will also join you for no other reason than keeping things interesting on being on the moderately pro Apple side. I do think I'm down the middle. I use an iPhone versus an Android device in terms of when it comes to smartphone and use PCs. So when it comes to, in fact, I've never actually had an Apple computer. I've never actually owned one or used one in a work environment other than, you know, just temporarily using one for some situation. My first exposure to Apple computers was, I think, in 1980 when the middle school that I attended was given an Apple II back when Apple was making its initial pushes into the education space. And it was locked up in the back of the library. I was a library assistant for one of the periods and had other access. So I was like one of the three or four students in the entire school who had access to the Apple II that we have in the back of the library. And that's where I first cut my teeth on a little bit of programming and BASIC as a programming language and some stuff like that. So I can say that the one time I ever really used an Apple product was way back in the day, which was an Apple II back when that was the thing actually at that point in time to some degree, and we'll talk a little bit about that.
Don, it still was when I was in grade school. So I started grade school in 1984, and we had Apple IIe's and Apple IIgs's in our grade school, and I had this actually very much the same experience. And if you would have asked me then, I would have said I was pro Apple.
Yeah,
because I had a good experience learning to program BASIC on an Apple IIe.
Go ahead.
No, I'll chime in with my first exposure to Apples. Same thing in my elementary school. Mine was a little different because where I grew up outside of Charlotte had a large population of IBM families. IBM banks had just started down there, and IBM opened up a pretty big facility, and that's why I'm from Charlotte. So my elementary school in 1989, 1990 had Apples, but a significant, or at least some of, you know, an interestingly large number of us, especially for it being 1990, had computers at home. So we were a little bit more familiar with other machines. I will say I probably died of diphtheria a dozen times before I had chicken pox. That's what it was used for. They were used for the Oregon Trail. I see heads nodding. People will get that. I will come out and say this. I do believe there should have been regulations to protect our children from this cult.
Well, you know, it's an interesting thing. And Brody, I'll ask you about your educational experience there in terms of what you find. Since you're still in school, we forget because Brody is so articulate and bright. We forget how young Brody is.
Brody's and the three old guys.
Yeah, exactly. That's what we could. In fact, we may entitle this episode that.
That's our garage band right there.
There you go.
Yeah.
Brody and the old dudes. So Brody and the educational environment today, do you see more? I'm assuming you see more PCs. Is Apple still have a presence there as it did in the past?
Well, I have to be very broad with this. Our school tends to use like Google products, or like I don't think our school owns a single MacBook or a single Apple computer.
Okay.
But just about every student has an iPhone. Just about every teacher has an iPhone. You're definitely in the minority if you have a Google phone or a whatever. And I'll probably chime in too with my first experience, because my first experience is probably with like my grandparents, who are really interesting. They have Google phones, but Apple for everything else.
You know, part of that, we'll probably get down this because it tells the story of how Apple worked as a commercial organization, which to me is also fascinating. They get that back to the Jobs and Wozniak situation there. But the experience that Chris, Eric, and I, Apple was intentionally, to your point, Chris, trying to create and gain traction by putting computers in schools. And then the other place I remember actually seeing my first Macintosh, really my first exposure to a Macintosh, was when I went to college in 1986. And in the honors program at University of Houston, down in the honors lounge, there were 7 or 8 of Macintoshes that were down there that were available for use. And these weren't the ones that were over in the library. I mean, you could actually get on one there because it was sort of nobody, you couldn't go there unless you were in the honors program and other stuff like that. And I'll tell you what fascinated me, because I had been exposed to, to computers somewhat generally, including, I guess our Apple II did have a disk. It had a floppy drive by the time I saw it there in middle school. So that, that was an improvement over loading programs from cassette tape, which, by the way, I did with one of the first computers I ever owned. It was saving programs to cassette tapes and loading them back in. That's, Brody, you would not believe the knives and bearskins we dealt with computer-wise growing up.
If I could actually pause, there used to be these plastic things.
Yeah, called cassettes.
USB drive. Well, no, it's a USB drive, but it was flattened out. And if you actually look at the save icon, it looked exactly like that.
Yeah,
we are getting to the point where people will not know what the save icon used to be.
That's true. And I remember the thing that jumped out at me about the first Mac that I had close experience to was the 3.5-inch hard floppy.
Yep.
It was a floppy that wasn't a floppy. And that was so cool because of how delicate dealing with a 5.25 had been and how you had to protect it. And suddenly there's this rigid thing that's smaller and easy to pop in your pocket. And I was just fascinated by the integrated 9-inch maybe grayscale screen, the mouse, all the things that was Macintosh. And we'll definitely talk about that, I'm sure. But the floppy drive was the thing that fascinated me more than anything, was this, rigid, smaller. It was like, wow, that's an improvement. Yeah. And that became the norm and the standard, for a long time in terms of even in the PC world, while we were, back when we used to think that, 1.44 megabytes was a lot of storage. That's a whole thing.
I probably still have some of those, Don, hanging out. Some of those old, the 3.5-inch, the hard disks. I probably still have some around here somewhere.
I actually eventually bought for like $8 off of Amazon a USB 3.5-inch floppy drive because I needed to read some stuff that I had that were, again, dating myself, WordPerfect 5.1 for DOS Word documents that I had to convert at some point. So just generally speaking, to get the conversation off the nostalgia part of it here, because we could spend on the nostalgia part, I think, forever. But well, just general, except for Brody.
Floppy disk. What is this? This is about my history classes, along with George Washington and the pyramids.
That's exactly right. And for you, they're about the same because they're all before you. In fact, what Brody was mentioning off podcast, and I'll start with this, is Brody basically, there has not been a time that you've been alive essentially when there wasn't an iPhone that you remember anyway. I mean, that's been ubiquitous for your entire life, right?
Yeah, I was born in 2006. First iPhone came out in 2008. I don't remember the first 2 years of my life, like most people.
Yeah, so hearing us, hearing the old guys here wax poetic about, it's a hard floppy disk, probably sounds a little bit funny, but do you think having that be, you were born into a time when Apple existed, and Apple existed primarily as a provider of smartphones? I mean, I think that is it's certainly their most profitable product now. It's the thing they sell the most of. They still sell computers, but their business now is the iPhone business.
And yeah,
there's no doubt about that. Do you have any perspective on that, Brody, that maybe Eric and Chris and I don't have? Because of your age, in terms of, I mean, do you even think about this as being Apple versus everybody else? Or there always was Apple. There always will be Apple, kind of thing.
I think it kind of really depends. Because, yes, there is definitely a rivalry. I'm not as firm on any one side as I'm just here watching like all the old guys fighting between Apple and Samsung and anti-Apple with no other real alternative. And but I think it's definitely changed like the way like the perception about the companies is. Like if you were to go to someone in my generation or like younger people who are not graduated from college, not graduated from high school, probably the I associate the smartphone most with Apple, but I associate like computers most with Google. Or like with like Apple's really won the smartphone space, but they've kind of lost everywhere else. Except for earbuds. They kind of won over with AirPods there.
Yeah, I think that's a fair thing. I think for your generation, you probably do think of Apple as more of a provider of smartphones than any. You know, they do other stuff, obviously, but that's the first place you put them. You know, I'm reminded of how there's so many companies that actually do different things now than we think of. You know, it's somebody was mentioning, you know, Maytag or Whirlpool. I may be wrong, either one of those, but you know, they actually make more things than just, you know, washers and dryers now. But that's the first thing you're going to think of is appliance. If somebody mentions, you know, a company like that, when they actually make all kinds of other parts that go into, you know, defense technologies and other things like that, that you don't think of them as being, you know, they're an appliance. GE is a great example of that. You know, for most of us of our generation, we think of them as being, you know, home appliance or a home electronics company. No, they have, you know, energy divisions, and they make things for the Department of Defense and all kinds of other things. I mean, they're GE is diverse, but when you think of them, you think, you know, of my generation, you think of them as being some GE appliance. I think Apple gets thought of as primarily being a phone company now, but they were a computer company back in the day. By the way,
And this
can
is
I just
more
mention?
broad beyond that. I'm
Yeah.
Chris.
Yeah, you referred to them as a phone company. When and this might be kind of the bubble for me, but when I hear phone company, I still think AT&T, Verizon, Bell.
No, that's
That's
like providers, but
yeah.
they're still around. I thought they went the way of the dodo.
They have to a great degree.
Some of
And
them have, yeah.
and really, I'm just gonna say something reminded by Chris's background, like Lucasfilm as well. Like if I say Lucasfilm, you're probably gonna think of Star Wars, which they made, but they also made like Indiana Jones, if I remember right. They made make a lot of other stuff too. Like so I was kind of very broad, but
I'm
get a reputation from one thing.
reminded of if you, anybody's ever seen the show 30 Rock, they make so much hay out of Alec Baldwin's character coming from corporate GE. That manufacturing culture being put into kind of an entertainment sector.
Right. Yeah, and I think of Letterman for the years that he was on NBC. You know, that was a constant theme of his railing against, you know, the in fact his exact I have it in my head right now, the pinheads at GE. You know, that was how he that's how he referred to them as, because they weren't the entertainment guys or didn't understand or grasp, you know, what was going on there. So going back to the time that we're talking about here, when they're, you know, it's the room where it happened. So this mythical garage. So what's the role of Apple in computers starting, I guess, in 70 from your guys' perspective? In other words, how important were the two Steves and to how we got to where we are today?
Well, I would say they're pretty important. I mean, I think with the way they started out was very important to the evolution of what we understand as modern personal computing. You know, I really think if you think about the kind of the early 70s, even into the mid 70s, mostly what existed in personal computing were hobbyists. I mean, we're thinking about like the Altair. These are kits. You had to put them together. You had to have some expertise. You know, these were engineers and tinkerers that were that were put it. It wasn't a closed system, as Chris is delicately touching his the apple in the background. I won't give any more than that away. But I think that they did bring a little bit of democratization to the idea that it's not necessarily the quote unquote right people that have personal computing. It's all people that have personal computing. And so I think that part of the original ethos, I think really made a lot of sense and resonated with a lot of people. And I think that's really that may be part of the secret to their early success. And I think Chris, did you do you have a homebrew computer?
Oh, I absolutely do. I have a That's actually what I was touching. I didn't realize it would be behind the. I do have a spare parts. It's literally bought it and built it from scratch. And yeah, I can do that on a Windows machine.
Right. But, absolutely. And I've done the same thing. I don't do that anymore, but mostly just because I don't have time. But in the past, I've built my own Windows machine, kind of PC Intel sort of architecture. And it's been great fun when I've been able to do that.
And to me, that's one of the ironies of the Apple story, to your point there, Eric, you know, Altairs and the other quote unquote kits that were out there that were popular. And of course, the way that Jobs and Wozniak get their start is they're going around to these various computer clubs that are there in the Silicon Valley, you know, these gatherings and groups. And these were the places you went to get help putting your kit together or figuring out how to do something if you wanted to have one. And they show up with this already built version of the Apple One, which is, you know, if you got money, you can have this. You don't actually have, you know, not Jobs, Wozniak, because Wozniak was the engineer, you know, the other Steve. And that's the way I think of him in my head, which is sad. He's the other Steve. That's a real sad place to be. But the other Steve has built this thing. Actually, I understand the first one was actually like in a wooden case. If you go back to like, you know, an early Apple One, and they were selling them, you know, building them and selling them to this place where people were building and selling their own. So back to what you guys described there, and I've done that in the past and have family that's in the, you know, the computer, the IT side of things, who built computers for me. I've helped them do it. That's all on the, you know, quote unquote IBM Windows side of the house. Nobody's building their, well, there may be somebody out there, but nobody's really building a homebrew Apple because it's a closed ecosystem. And so to me, the irony, and I think it truly is irony, of the rise of Apple in the 70s and then what it becomes is the two Steves are in that, let's build, you know, that whole culture of let's build stuff ourselves and put it together. But then once they put it together, now you just buy the fully completed unit. Don't be out there putting stuff together. Just buy the stuff we've already done and the closed ecosystem that becomes Apple. I find that ironic.
I don't think so. I think it's Wozniak's coming out of that world.
Mm-hmm.
Jobs is coming out of a other mindset where I'm going to control this, kind of what you were talking about what we've heard about his management style and everything. Wozniak built him a device and did not pay attention to how it was used. And the Jobs just kind of building that ecosystem of, it's really interesting to me kind of thinking about that Super Bowl commercial and thinking about kind of how at least I view Apple of, here's this complete almost gray, like, we're going to decide for you what you need in a phone. Here, take it and walk away.
You and know he would what even I mean? Talk about end-to-end user control. I mean, Jobs was very upfront about what he wanted. And yeah. In fact, they had a special tool. It was a special screwdriver. You probably remember this, Don, and you may too, Chris, on the older Macintoshes, when you wouldn't go to the back. It wasn't a hex bolt, it wasn't a Phillips screwdriver. It was a special tool that you needed to use because they didn't want everybody to be able to get into the case.
Yeah. And you know, we made reference to it here. The 84 Super Bowl commercial that we're talking about, it's in one of your trivia questions, Eric, that you posted there in the forum. So I'd encourage our listeners to go to the website and go look at those. Is Super Bowl ad. Super Bowl ads were really starting to come into being what we know as Super Bowl ads in the early 80s. That's where this genesis of what we have today was really coming forward. And one of those ads, the director is Ridley Scott. Ridley Scott, known for a lot of things, known for Blade Runner, I guess, at that point being one of the things he would have been known for. He's known for, you know, these big, huge things. So getting this movie director, this film director, to direct a commercial is a big deal. And 1984 is a big deal. For those of you that know George Orwell and that novel, by the way, Animal Farm is his better work. I just always have to plug that in anytime I talk about Orwell. Everybody's rather familiar with 84. Animal Farm is the one you ought to read in my mind first and then do 84. But so we're rolling into 1984 being 1984. And we're also rolling into the period of time where now IBM has come into the personal computing space, a lot of that through Radio Shack and Tandy. But, you know, Radio Shack plays a big story in this that gets overlooked a lot. The Tandy computers, the TRS-80 computers, because that was the first thing I saw that wasn't an Apple that was at any place either. And so we're rolling up on what is now the early days of the PC wars between Apple and between IBM and IBM clones. That's the open closed architecture battle that was also going on at the period of time. And so we get to 1984 and Apple's on the verge of releasing this product, which is going to be revolutionary in ways, lots of ways. That's the Macintosh product. And so they tout it as being basically going up against IBM, who they now equate to Big Brother. And so the ad is this very powerful, it's this wonderful mix of things, because it's obviously picking up on the 1984 Big Brother, you know, the big screen, the big talking head, the masses that are just sort of, hypnotized into listening to whatever this thing on the screen is telling them.
Just picture a black and white announcement version of when Steve Jobs used to keep running out with his new iPhone.
Exactly. And then it's also capturing 1984 as an Olympic year in the United States, because the whole image is like this female who, by the way, she's the only thing that's in color sort of in the ad, who's coming in, and she's got, it's like a hammer, like the hammer from track and field. And she's throwing this hammer and she's breaking the big screen. And then the voiceover with like a simple text. There has to be a YouTube link out there, so I'll find the YouTube link and include it in the show notes for those that aren't familiar with this. You know, basically they're talking about the release date of the Macintosh. And the whole point is, well, you'll see why 1984 is not going to be 1984. And it was this whole idea of little upstart Apple is taking on Big Blue, which is also, when we talk about mythos, that's mythos at this point too. Apple was a big boy company at this point and had been profitable and all kinds of other things, but yet they're still playing that role, that California countercultural outsider role of, you know, we're trying to take down IBM, who wants to tell you how to do things. Eric, looks like you want to say something.
No, not necessarily. I was just kind of musing over the commercial. One thing that actually is interesting is they kind of tout themselves as this, you know, American company with this California ethos. The athlete in question was not American. She was English. So I don't know, that's neither here nor there, but I thought it was very interesting that they couldn't find an American Olympic runner in 1984 when the Olympics were in Los Angeles. Seems like that would have been an easy thing to find, but no,
easy thing to find.
Yeah. Her name is Anya Major.
Oh, wow. So there you go. I've now learned something I didn't know today.
I'm going to jump here to answer the original question that got us down this rabbit hole.
Yeah.
Is Apple important? Well, we're doing this. We're on computers here recording. Personal computers, really a product of what Apple gave us. What Apple gave us was the democratization of information. Like, before the 70s, we were still in like more of an age of exploration, discovery, colonization, like the lunar landings and all that. Now we're in the age of information. Like, it's an entirely different landscape. Because if you wanted to spread information before the 1970s, you would have to write a book, some other sort of writing. It had to be published. It would have to go through a long, huge process to only reach a few dozen people. Whereas now we can sit down on a Saturday morning and we can record probably what's going to end up being like an hour of content, put it out. Now over 100 people can see this by the end of the day. If not, you definitely should.
I agree. We talk about being in the information age, and I think you can argue that it began, you know, before 1976 to some degree, but you're right. The democratization of technology and computer technology certainly grows from that point on, such to where literally sitting here, I mean, literally within eyeshot, I've got three personal computers here of a small variety, and, you know, work-related, personal-related, et cetera. And you're right. We actually have, and, you know, and then the growth of the internet really changes everything with that, and how those personal computers can now be networked in a way that we choose to have them network, not because they're forced to be on a network, which is what they were at the time that Wozniak and Jobs are, you know, you had terminals. In fact, one of the things Wozniak first designed was a terminal to connect to various forms of mainframes. And if you've never dialed up using the terminal protocol at a 1200 baud modem, you ain't lived, is all I'm saying. But I did that as a kid. You haven't lived through that, and be thankful that you didn't, Brody. I mean, and you know, literally, where you know that the I can't even make the sound, but the handshake sound that a modem makes. You know, when you heard that, and then you waited a minute or two for that first thing to finally pop up on the screen, and then you know, moving it. You think anything now is, you can't imagine the speed of that. I mean, it was just so incredible. Yeah,
lines of text would go, you'd see the lines of text come through when you're receiving it. Yeah. I had that pleasure too, Don. We had an old acoustic coupler. Okay, Brody, Brody, I got to explain this to you. Cause this is going to make no sense.
Yeah. This is all going to make sense.
Yeah, so it's acoustic coupler. So the phone, the actual physical landline phone that we, by the way, we didn't own, we rented from Bell.
The phone company.
Yeah, it was the phone company. We rented from Bell, and it would, which for us eventually was Southwestern Bell once they broke them up into baby bells. And then you actually set the phone on this device with these two little cups. And then the actual acoustic coupler device talked and the phone talked to each other, and you had this, you know, this horrible sound, this while they're handshaking. See, I got that, Don.
Yeah, you're pretty
and,
good.
And they would talk to each other, and then you would start seeing your text, and it was only text at that point that would come through. And the thing is at the time, because this is what we had and we didn't know any different, it absolutely blew our minds that we could do this.
Yeah. I knew this was going to turn nostalgic, which is okay, because that's sort of what it's about, is that, you know, we have this nostalgia related to both of these product sets, but that seems so it was archaic compared to now, and it seems so archaic compared to now, but at the time it was groundbreaking, which makes Brody's point. The fact that you know, suddenly there were BBS, here's another term, mm-hmm. you have to explain to, yep. you had these bulletin boards, these things you could log on to, and you know, and you could exchange. The closest thing we have to that now sort of is the way that forums tend to work, maybe a Reddit type of thing, is, you know, they're the outgrowths of the early bulletin boards. But you know, the early bulletin board, you had to know what the phone number was. Somebody may have had to set you up and give you a password. So there was still it wasn't the big internet that we think of today, but it was a way for people who had like interests to connect. And then, you know, email does sort of flow off the backside of that, the other things that grow from that. And when you really think about, you know, like putting a mark in the sand, like in 76, I mentioned 86, so a decade later, you know, seeing my up close first experience with Macintosh really for the first time, to the first PC that I think I owned as an adult, that's got to be around the early 90s. Before that, by the way, I actually owned a Commodore 128. That will date myself. But I'll talk a little bit about something that in a minute, because it's relevant to this and sort of the growth of Apple, which I think is one of the key things that Apple did bring. Is you see the evolution over time, then you see the evolution just in Brody's lifetime, and what he mentioned here is it's pretty remarkable where we've come from, and it's really remarkable for the last 10 to 15 years. Yeah, I can't imagine the world without the smartphone now. Well, you know, that's not that long ago.
Two things. One, I kind of, and I think Don and I kind of discussed this in kind of a preliminary, I see computing as a giant U in this way. It starts out with the era of the mainframes. And again, coming from an IBM family, I grew up hearing stories about computer bugs being bugs that had gotten caught in the mainframe computer and caused problems that way. And you had terminals. And in that era, all the processing was done in a central location. And the terminals just allowed dispersed use of it. What at the next generation, and this is kind of still what we're talking about, Apple and the personal computer cuts those lines, cuts those networking communications, because now you can have that processing at home. The third wave is when we get to reliable, fast connections, where we actually can go back to centralized computing. And I find it interesting, Brody, that you're talking about coming to us on a Chromebook. Chromebooks are specifically designed as kind of that third wave of computing where they're basically expecting you to have a connection to a server, which is another term for a remotely stored mainframe, to do a lot of your processing. Next thing I'm going to mention, wonderful connection to all of this. This was before my time, but I grew up with it. If you ever want to see an acoustic coupler, go to YouTube and watch the entire feature film of War Games.
Yeah. And you will see there, that was in 80, I think War Games is 83, 82 or 83, if my memory is serving me correctly. And you're right, he acoustic coupler, and his interface when he's talking to the, you know, the, what he's more or less, he's hacked in, he's an early hacker, so he's hacked into a system, and anyway, the acoustic coupler, it's text on the screen, so you'll see that there. He's interacting with, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 push menu kind of stuff, and then the next thing comes. He's astonished by the thing on the other end, seems to be a little bit smarter than what he's expecting, you know, because there's no AI yet really in terms of how we think of AI. I think that's an interesting point to sort of talk about, because that's a crossover period. This is right before that iconic ad I talked about in Macintosh. This is still sort of the IBM-ish age, but it's the homebrew age. It's what's there as well. And, you know, the thing we haven't talked about here is, yes, it democratized computing, but it made it useful. And the Apple II was great. You could play a great little game called Oregon Trail. Somebody made a reference to that earlier. That was pretty popular and common. I remember the first basic programs that I wrote, imagine this, were little baseball simulators that would actually, like, you know, do a random number calculation and tell you what happened. I remember doing that and some other things as well, because there really wasn't graphical things. They were text-based games for the most part. You know, maybe a little bit of graphic here and there, but the so long story short is it's not until the first killer app comes along for Apple that you really see the growth of the need for this Apple, this personal computer. Why do I need a personal computer? Well, to play games. Well, I'm not going to spend that much money to play, you know, to play games, you know, for my kids to play games. Is this little program called VisiCalc that's referred to as the first quote-unquote killer app. So I see Eric nodding up and down. I see a little bit of a nod from Chris. I don't have Brody visually on my screen, but I'm guessing, is this the first you've ever heard the term VisiCalc, Brody?
Never heard of it.
Yeah, VisiCalc was Excel's great, 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 maybe a couple of more greats grandparent. It's the first, if you will, spreadsheet in any way, shape, form, or fashion. This is even before Lotus, again, probably another term that you have to be of a certain generation to really appreciate that Lotus used to own that market, Lotus 1-2-3, because everything's Excel now. That's a whole, there's probably a whole other room that we need to find. That's the Microsoft room that we need to talk about, what, you know, to go down that other path there at some point. But VisiCalc was a spreadsheet. Pretty primitive by modern standards, but spreadsheets were big. The ability to actually do what you could do inside of a spreadsheet, and it ran and worked well on an Apple II. And so suddenly there was a reason for people in the quote-unquote business world to have this personal computer at home, and it was the ability to do basic spreadsheet calculation functions. And that also altered the course and the trajectory here, that without VisiCalc, the Apple II just may be a nice, easier version of that homebrew computer kit that goes nowhere for some period of time, or just as a smarter dumb terminal to connect to bulletin boards and to other mainframes.
Yeah, and even though it came out in, I think it was early 80s, Don, if I'm remembering right, I still remember using VisiCalc on Apple IIs, even probably into the early 90s because we were using Apple IIs in an educational context. So, you know, it was a reasonably good program for the time.
Yeah. And, you know, and was powerful enough to be valuable. Right. And, you know, so I think that's something that we overlook, is that, you know, again, the mythos of the garage here, to, you know, tie back to the original thing. I know we've wandered all over the place, but that's okay. I think we're doing good stuff here. Is that may be meaningless if it doesn't find an actual useful purpose. And that useful purpose, you'll hear over and over again by technology historians and computer historians, is VisiCalc. VisiCalc made Apple and Apple IIs a serious thing. And it also, even more the reason now where IBM and others says we got to get into that space. The little aside I want to take here, and we did an episode on A Fork in Time about this. It's also the fascinating story. I strongly recommend Robert Cringely's Revenge of the Nerds. If you have a chance to look at that, which is a PBS thing from the mid 90s, is that a lot of what Apple eventually became was not about what was done in that garage, which I think is the other thing that we need to talk about here. There's a little company called Xerox. You may have heard of them, that had this place out in Palo Alto near the Silicon Valley area where the two Steves are. They had this place called PART, Palo Alto Research Center. And everything you know about even the computer that I'm looking at now, I'm looking at a graphical user interface on my screen. Everything you know about computing today, that Apple was a big player in bringing it to the forefront for Macintosh and some of their things. And then Windows comes along. You know, you can say that Windows stole from Apple, but Apple didn't create those things. Who created that stuff? Xerox created that stuff at the Palo Alto Research Center, the Alto computers. And so, again, part of that mythos of Apple, well, yeah, but they didn't invent everything that they are known for. And that includes graphical user interface, object-oriented programming, the mouse, all of these things that we associate with, you know, sort of being Apple's innovation, particularly through the Macintosh, weren't originally Apple.
Yeah, I think where they excelled is kind of seeing where technology was headed and be able to capitalize on technology that other people had invented, even though people like Xerox and people like IBM didn't always catch on right away.
Yeah. We mentioned the pinheads at GE, you know, the
PART folks,
yeah, the Xerox folks out in California, and they had created this place to explore ideas. It was amazing what they did, and then fumbled the ball on it, so to speak, is that they would talk about the copier heads back on the East Coast who didn't quite grasp what they had out there and they developed in terms of computer technology, Ethernet, mm-hmm. I mean, just all kinds of stuff, you know. If you don't know the story of Xerox PART, the story of Xerox PART is a fascinating thing, and how those people became like the electronic dispara into the computer world, as they all left from there and went to the various places and made tons of money. But Jobs had the chance to see what they were doing there, and they let him walk out of there with the concepts and the code because they were just so disgruntled with Xerox. And so that leads to the Macintosh. So moving, go ahead, buddy.
Okay, two complete side notes. One humorous, one with some actual meaning. 1970s, most people the Steve's age were doing something in their garage, working on cars, playing in a band. They'd be the ultimate nerds to be building a computer in the garage while everybody else was working on cars. Other thing, this is also kind of like a part of what came to like be like the idea of the American dream, like where you could have like two college dropouts builds one of the biggest companies in the world to the point now where like Apple is this giant monolith company that has such a huge influence, and like other companies that, while Xerox may not be around anymore, although I have heard of them. I would say living under a rock, but then again, I'm sure if you asked 115-year-olds, maybe one or two would be able to tell you what a Xerox was.
Exactly right.
Quitter.
Yeah.
Well, I have to, these are things I have to explain to my kids. And so Brody, my kids are all just, my oldest is just a couple years younger than you. And so when I say things like Xerox something instead of copy it, they look at me like I'm crazy. And I've explained landline phones to them. I've explained television antennas to them. Yeah. I mean, it's because it's just these are really alien concepts for people that have grown up like you have, Brody, is, you know, they've always had this information at their fingertips.
We could probably have a complete podcast telling me all these terms that I've completely unfamiliar with.
That would actually be really fun. As you, Brody, you can have my oldest and you and I can go on and I'll talk about just a bunch of of crazy terms from the 70s and 80s that I grew up with, and you tell me what you think it is.
Or more this idea. I believe my office has a Xerox. It's actually a Xerox. But I think the idea that Xerox is still going to be the verb, even though it's no longer going to be a noun. If we have English nerds out there, Brody, when you enter the workforce, when you get out and have an office job, I feel like people are still going to talk about Xeroxing things. Just, it won't be a noun. It will be a verb, almost the way jacuzzi has become the term, and you don't know it actually used to be like the company.
Google's moving that way. Absolutely. For a company, now Google, if you want to know something, you Google it.
Absolutely,
you
a verb.
Actually Google it. If you have Apple, you're using Safari. If you have, you can have like Internet Explorer, Firefox, a bunch of other search engines.
Nobody uses Internet Explorer other than to download Chrome.
That's exactly where I was going to go. Was how Google is the 21st century of now becoming verb, like Xerox was to a great degree. Mm-hmm. But the other interesting part to me that sort of goes with that is, you're mentioning there, Microsoft has a search engine called Bing. Nobody says, let's go Bing something, because whoever gets to the space first sort of owns the space. I think of that way, even tying this back to Apple. There were other devices out there in the 2008-ish period of time that were morphing the cell phone into something different. This company called BlackBerry. You want to talk about another company that fumbled things? BlackBerry probably falls in that category, because at one point from 2004-ish, maybe through 2010, in the corporate world, they were the mobile device of preference, because they were using what had become the killer app, their email, which comes along and becomes the killer app. They were able to adapt that to being mobile and on the fly very well. But when smartphone is an Apple thing. Granted, it was an iPhone, but the idea of the concept of the smartphone, I think they brought that into culture such that it, when people talk about, I do know people that use iPhone in almost the same way to be the proxy word, meaning a smartphone in general. I mean, there are probably ones who use iPhones that are more that way, but that's until Android came along to challenge that. That was the direction we were also heading there. Are you going to have an old style Motorola StarTech, an actual flip phone kind of thing, or do you have an iPhone? Meaning that was going to be the next version of a Xerox or a Google, until Android, comes along, and now it's the smartphone environment, not just the iPhone environment.
So, and I think some of us had sort of an intermediate path. I know when I was a resident, this would have been 2005, 2006 era. I had a flip phone, but then I also had a Palm Pilot.
Yes.
And I had a Palm Pilot that was it had Wi-Fi, and so I could use it in many ways the same way we would use a smartphone, but it was two separate devices that I had to use. And eventually, probably about 2007 is when I got my first BlackBerry. And so that was kind of the foray. And at that point, it really was a legitimate smartphone. It didn't have a touch screen, but it was a legitimate smartphone in a lot of ways.
Yeah. And
the thing I would think about is, Apple may have been first to the PC space, or one of the first ones there, but that control thing, I remember in the mid to late 90s, being a kid, I would go to a store and actually buy software. And there would be racks and racks and racks of software, and there'd be one rack for stuff that actually worked on an Apple, because of that control. They had that, and they still do have that mindset of control, that we control this and are just going to hand you something and you're going to use. And we're talking now about the iPhone. Remember for how long have the iPhones been one release a year, and this is what you're getting? While on the other hand, if you look into the Android or the Windows space, there are so many different varieties of what's out there to fit what somebody wants that I think that's, you know, that's what killed a lot of their computer business, is when other people caught up and realized, you know what, we can have software. Our software can be the network externality. In other words, everybody's using our software, and we don't even need to get into a hardware department. We don't need to actually worry about producing the physical devices. We can let other people worry about that, who, by the way, are very good at that and specialize in that, and we don't even need to worry about that. So I feel like the Windows world, even though it's a different company, is now, that spot has been taken by the Google world, who, yeah, they played around with the Pixel and they experimented with having a physical device, but they never said, you know what, we are going to control this entire environment and not let anybody experiment on it.
Yeah, and even back to the analogy of that is back to the is IBM in the 80s. We talk about IBM machines. They were IBM compatibles. You know, it might have been a Compaq. You know, later it would become a Dell or become a Gateway. You know, the various dominant players sort of in that, especially the consumer side of that market over time have changed. You know, dude, you're getting a Dell. Now I'm dating myself there again, probably also again before Brody, right?
I have memory of those. Like, that's what's sitting in, like, the computer lab in school. I know what that is.
Yeah, before that though, Gateway was in a big place. Before that, you know, Compaq was huge especially in the Houston area in the mid 80s. I mean, they were going, and before they became part of HP, there's another name. You know, I had a Packard Bell. I think my first personal computer was a Packard Bell. I mean, the point being there, we refer to those as IBM machines. They're IBM compatibles. I think very few people actually had a true IBM PC. Maybe in the business world you did, because there's the old adage about nobody ever got fired for buying IBM, right? That exists in the business world. But Google,
I had IBMs. Dad brought them home from work, but that's about why I did.
Yeah. But what's interesting to me there, which, you know, ties back again, this is the Apple story and the closed versus open architecture thing, which I think is their story all the way through. And there's analogies in all kinds of other ways as well. Is you're right. Google still does and did make hardware, but what they really on the smartphone side, what they really did was create an operating system and saying, everybody else go forth, license our operating system from us. We'll make money on doing that, in much the same way that Microsoft makes money today. We don't care what it's running on. We just want it running someplace. You call it whatever you want to. That we make money on the operating system side of things and through programs and software. Yeah, programs and software delivered on, never mind. We actually had to go to a place with a box and bring something home. You know, that's so foreign to us now. It's also unbelievable. But the thing that I was going to say that I think is, talking about to that, your perspective is right, Chris, in terms of Apple telling you what you need and delivering up what you need. That's, I think, viewed properly so from the negative perspective of, you're boxing me in and telling me, ironically, you're becoming Big Brother, even though in 1984 you said it wasn't going to be Big Brother, right? It's okay if I'm Big Brother is the point. It's not okay if somebody else gets to be Big Brother. But the flip side of that is where I think Apple has excelled is in user experience, user interface, and intuitiveness. The amazing thing to me, for example, about an iPhone and almost any other Apple product over time, Macintosh had this to a degree when it was bringing the graphical user interface into the place, into the space, later with iPods, you know, then iPads, is that you normally don't need a user manual to figure out how to use an Apple product. And that is very intentional. And that's a byproduct of deciding what it's going to be. It's going to be a closed infrastructure. It's all going to work together the way that it works together, whether you like that or not. It's going to work that way, which means that when you get presented with it, you're able to very quickly pick up on how it's going to work. They make, I think, one of the strengths that we forget about because it's just so subtle, they make incredibly intuitive products. And if you look at other things in the computer space or in the adjacent space like smartphones, not all those things are equally intuitive. The example that I give that's personal is an 86-year-old mother-in-law who finally gave up her essentially traditional cell phone after 10 years, the only real options, real option in the space was to get some variant of a smartphone. I mean, yeah, they make the Shutterfly, the Bugfly, whatever that one is, that's sort of, you know, intentionally designed to be an easy to use basic cell phone, which is what she, although she texts. So, you know,
targeted to old people. We are not old. It's not targeted to us.
Right. But her first smartphone was an Android device. Now, part of it was I didn't have an Android device. So trying to lock that down to make it easier for her to use, for it to be intuitive, became so difficult that eventually she's on an iPhone now. And the reason for that was not because one's better than the other, but because the intuitive user experience on the iPhone is exactly that. It's more intuitive. That is a growth out of, talking about Jobs here again, very much that was what he was about user experience, the aesthetic of how you're using it, maybe being too far in that extreme of you can't do that because it's going to be this way. But it's going to be this way is a positive aspect for those that like what it does and like being in that space. There's consistency there, and it does all work together without you needing to know the behind the scene things. If you're Chris or Eric or others who understand that well enough and want to play with the behind the scene things and tweak that, that's, you're then frustrated by the very thing that's actually a feature to somebody else, if that makes any sense.
No, that's I think perfectly described, Don. And that really summarizes both the kind of what I perceive as the positive and negative aspects of Apple. And I know, like, my wife has an iPhone too, but she's not going to listen to this. So I can say she is very non-technical. She's not good with technology. And so for that reason, she likes the iPhone because it does what it does, and I don't need to worry about the rest. But then when she gets a new iPhone, she's like, oh, this new iPhone does this. And I'm like, yeah, mine's been doing that for a couple of generations now.
I full disclosure, my little sister poisoned the rest of my family against me. My 25-year IBM man father has an iPhone. The rest of my family has iPhones. I will never give up. But
your next month, give me an iPhone.
Never. You can hand me one. I will use it as a paperweight.
I'm already looking at upgrading after 3 years. I'm looking at upgrading one of this new Samsung flip phones, like the ones that flip out into the big, yep, the big whole screen.
Yes,
those are pretty cool.
Yeah.
Well, and the other thing that we forget, we're talking about computers here. We wandered back from the 70s computers to, you know, current generation. Smartphones, iPhones, and Android operating system phones, is my first personal computer. I remember paying for the upgrade on the hard drive so that it would have a big whopping hold your horses here, guy, 60 megabytes versus 40 megabytes. I said mega there, not giga. I said mega for those, and not tera for those of you playing at home. You know, the computing power on the smartphone that's here over to my right is several orders of magnitude superior to what that machine was in terms of processing speed. I want to say it had a 20 megahertz processor inside of it. So again, we're measuring speed in mega, we're measuring storage in mega. Now we're talking about gigahertz, and we're talking about storage size. We're talking about terabytes, you know, of data, and even pushing beyond that in some ways, you know, pretty quickly for a lot of folks, is that the morphing of technology. I mean, to me, the part of the other Apple story, which is where I'm going there, yes, they make computers, and yes, they're still in that space, and they're still working in that space, and still, you know, still trying to be in that space, you know, the MacBooks and the Airs, the iPads are becoming as powerful as computers were 10 years ago or more so that you can almost do everything you need to do on that type of device. But Apple started out as a computer company that then sort of became a music company, because the next big thing that it transitioned to after computers really was the digital music world with the iPod. That led them into being a digital subscription company, which changed their model a lot. iTunes, you know, is a big part of the iPod story. Then the smartphone really is an outgrowth of, can we can we take all the benefits of an iPod, put it into this device you're already carrying? That's where it really started, because Motorola had a music capable playing phone at that time. Motorola, again, Brody, was this company that actually used to own the mobile space that is basically totally gone now from that space. Again, it's amazing how many companies are left by the side of the road while Apple just keeps rolling on. That's the other part of this. But
there's like Apple and Google and Microsoft, and that's about it now.
That's about it. And again, there was I mentioned RIM for the BlackBerry devices. I've mentioned tons of computer makers here. They've been, and yet Apple, Microsoft, and Google, I guess Alphabet now technically, because it's a broader scope than what it was, have managed to move on. Apple has done that by morphing who it is over time, whether you like it or not. They're a smartphone company now, for the most part, that dabbles in computers.
That what you just said was the adaption between the second and third generation that I was talking about. We used to go to, okay, I wasn't quite of the age to go to a record or a CD store and buy music that way. But that concept of using the internet to keep in mind, I am very much of a Napster age, but that what iTunes did was it gave you the access to this music. It didn't give you those files. And the core philosophy, the concept behind that is you're using a device that will be able to connect to the internet quickly, reliably, and from a bunch of different places. So that core underlying understanding of it is that shift from the second generation, where, I'm sorry, Apple was probably going away, to that third generation, into a new space that gave the company a new lease on life.
Well, they were 90 days from bankruptcy in the late 90s. I mean, when they had acquired Next and brought Jobs back, they were very close to bankruptcy. And now I just looked at what their market cap is today. $2.45 trillion is what the Apple enterprise is worth now. So yeah, Chris, you're exactly right. They pivoted, and they pivoted hard.
At least 30% of that is adapters for something or other.
I'm sure that's probably true, because I still have a bunch of 30, I still have a bunch of 30 pin stuff that doesn't fit anything now, but which is also, you know, ironic there. I got to have a lightning this or, you know, that. And again, you even talked about, you, somebody mentioned USBs earlier, or it was mentioned off podcast, you know, how many different flavors have there been of the USB too, you know, kind of thing. But to me, that is, you know, bringing some of this all around full circle. I mean, it felt like we wandered around, but I think we wandered around to interesting places here, is that the story of Apple to me is this company that did morph and adapt over time and has managed to have five or six lives now because of its ability to pivot and do that. I think whether you like them or don't like them, you have to respect the fact that they figured out how to do that over and over again. Reinventing yourself as an individual, or reinventing yourself as a company, is not an easy thing to do. And Apple's done it at least 2, 3, 4 times that I can easily identify, and other companies have it. That's why they're still hanging around. That's the challenge now, actually, of a Google, is they are working on reinventing themselves as well. Brody mentioned that he's using a Chromebook there. To your point, Chris, that really is actually hearkening back to an old way of doing things. Everything old is new again. But they've realized, you know, being a search engine and being, by the way, owning every piece of data you never want anybody to know about you that they do, and they can sell and profit from you, you know, is their model. But they also realize that, you know, there's computing is an interesting place now. What's going on with Microsoft? If you're familiar at all with the Microsoft 365 world, you know, that was the Office 365 world. Just in the last couple of weeks, they've now rolled out Windows 365, which is the whole concept of, you don't really own a computer. It's a lot more like the Chromebook approach to things. You have a device that, assuming you're always going to have a fast enough, quality enough connection, and your computer just exists in the cloud. You know, you pay for your computer a little bit each month by having Windows in the cloud. You just need a device to interface with it. And, you know, that's going to push Apple to go to some places if they're going to stay in the computer business, because they'll have no choice. Microsoft is the big player there, particularly on the business side. Google's in that space.
Speaking of staying in the computer business, I actually have to tell a story. I mean, again, IBM was like the family company to me. It's deep there. And I'm talking 2010, my boss's daughter got a job with them. They are completely different. I mean, they are not a computer company anymore. They do consulting and data stuff. And so they've also kind of reinvented themselves out of that space. And it really broke my heart to hear some of what she was saying. But that is another company that really changed.
I'm going to jump in here along the same line as what we've just been saying, but also going against everything we've been saying beforehand. The way Apple's reinvented itself now, it used to be an entirely closed system. Now, like, if you have a phone, if you have an iPhone, a smartphone, chances are the majority of the time you're using that phone, you're not using necessarily an Apple app, aside from maybe basic calling, texting. You're probably using, like Gmail or Google for email or search, or like a million other things. Like, now Apple's had to adapt in that way to allow for, at least on the software side, for people to create this whole, and it's created this whole ecosystem of making apps and producing apps, selling apps, which is really profitable for Apple because they now own an entire market in the literal sense. They own the App Store. So now they don't just have like this full complete control. They're more of a gatekeeper almost on the software side, even if the hardware side is completely inaccessible.
And Brody, you bring up a good point that you're absolutely right in that a lot of the customization really is in the software. It's interesting though that when I talk to friends who are app developers, there is a very big difference though in the experience that they relate in terms of developing versus iOS versus Android, just in terms of the accessibility of each operating system. That generally your Android is far more accessible than the iOS. But you're still, the point is still very true, Brody, is that you know, people are customizing their Apple products with software instead of hardware.
Well, and I remember my first iPhone, which I guess was an iPhone 3. I waited a couple of years before I jumped into the smartphone space because I have a traditional communications background, and I really miss my Motorola StarTAC flip phone that made me feel like I was James Kirk calling up to the Enterprise to be beamed up. I miss that because it worked really well as a phone.
Well, hold on though. Remember, Eric just talked about we're getting flip phones back. Samsung just came out with theirs.
Well, and I will say I do not have any disclosures for Samsung. They're not paying me to say this, but I am looking forward to my Samsung. I think they call it a Flip Z.
Yeah.
Or Galaxy Z Flip, I think is what it's called. I'm looking forward to that. It looks pretty cool.
Yeah, and the reason I bring that up is that's what I very quickly realized, even in the early days of what Brody's correctly identified there, is that ecosystem that's around applications, and they're not all Apple applications. I mean, there's what's loaded on your phone is Apple, although now, you know, you may have other apps that are preloaded on your iPhone. I quickly came to realize as a phone, it's okay. It's not ideally what I would have as a phone compared, but this is really because of the ubiquitous nature of data connections, which are coming along at the same time. That's the marriage of what happens there. This is an application delivery device. Phone just happens to be the primary application that's being taken over by text very quickly at the same time.
As a thought experiment, turn on airplane mode when you wake up in the morning. How useful is your phone over the course of the day where it doesn't have that connectivity?
Or maybe don't try this, but if you do, my phone broke like a few days ago. So now I'm back using an old iPhone 5 with all the basic preloaded apps. You can hardly do anything with it.
Right.
Like, aside from like basic texting and calling, which how little of that I do makes me realize just how much I use other things on my phone. Like everything, like I would advise not breaking your phone. But if you do, it's an interesting thought experiment.
Always good advice, Brody.
I think that's very true, is that we don't realize how that changes now in very short spans of time. I was going to mention this earlier, but you know, when we talk about the, you know, we normally talk about generations. We've talked about things like acoustic couplers here, and we've talked about, you know, 1200 baud, remember 2400 baud modems. Boy, that was double the speed, man. You know, the fact that we even baud was the unit of measure. You know, now we measure in megabits per second, you know, kind of thing, which is a whole other several orders of magnitude. Is, you know, the realization that because technology advances at the pace that technology advances, which is really fast, that you can be just 2 and 3 years difference in age during these past 40 years and have had very different experiences. You know, Brody reminds me of that, being here where he is, you know, being in his middle teens now, his experience is very different, but that's not just because he's substantially younger than the other three of us, but that would be true even if he were 10 years older. It would be true. It'd be true even if he were only 3 years younger, because there's a difference between, for example, my wife and I, who are only separated by 4 years, but that critical 4 years when computers were rolling out into the educational workspace and college and what you did, that carries over to where she exists today in terms of her level, because of what she does and her level of interactions with computers. I mean, she, you know, it can be frustrating at times to play the home IT guy, to play the home network administrator, because I deal with it all day long. But some of that has seeds back to 30 plus years ago in terms of, you know, if you'd been 3 years later or 3 years younger, what you had exposure to. And that is in that period of time when Apple and the computer wars were going on and all that, and what you got familiar with. And a lot back to the idea of smartphones here, to bring it full circle forward, what you would adopted probably around 2010 in the smartphone space is mostly where you are. Very few people do make the, they will. There certainly, you know, there are people that have made the switch from one ecosystem to the other, because there really are two ecosystems out there. There's the Android ecosystem and the iOS ecosystem. But you sort of set yourself down a path at some point where, because of the way you have things configured, the apps that you have, the things you've already paid for, you know, to make a switch, to suddenly decide I'm done with Apple, I'm going to go Android, I'm done with Android, I'm going to go Apple, it's a time investment. It's a money investment. We have two camps because each of the camps does a really good job of keeping you inside the camp.
It's like a religion. Like you, like there's,
it's a cult.
Big incentive to not switching over.
Yeah. Apple's a cult.
Hey, by the
way, that's about right. I'm thinking about where I was in 2010, Don, and I realized that was right around the time when I migrated from a BlackBerry device to my first Galaxy device. And so that as I recall, so that was that. So I think your notion of 2010 as being a bright line sounds about right.
Yeah, and again, and you know, not saying that people don't move between those two systems, that people don't move in the computer world between the Apple world and the non-Apple world, but people, again, this goes back to the very first thing I said. We could talk about red, blue, Democrat, Republican, you know, Yankees, everybody else, you know, Marianne versus Joe, all those things. But people do divide into these two camps for reasons that it's tough to get out of those camps.
And the one thing I'm thinking, I have some pretty stronger opinions about this, but we were talking about sports teams. And I think sports teams are an interesting analogy to which mobile ecosystem you're in, because some of those other things have deeper, you know, why are you one way or the other? But when it comes to this, I have very strong opinions. I think, you know, if you're Apple, well, okay, you get this because you don't know any better. But I also realize I am very biased. And I think for a lot of people, it is just random one way or the other. And then they're in that camp. And, you know, I feel like sports is another interesting of those examples where people get dug into what they are, but there's not a whole, and they get really dug into it, but there's not background.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you know what you know, which is the other part of that. I think Brody, Brody sort of raised this point. We talked about, you know, he doesn't remember a time really before smartphones because of his age. But if your first device of any type, or your first computer, your first smartphone, your first music player, you know, Microsoft had this thing called a Zune. You hear it occasionally referenced on like Big Bang Theory. I remember when Zune was coming out, you know, good reason to believe they ought to be able to take down Apple and the iPod at that point, but they didn't. And that was because Apple came along and did the Nano and the Cube and other things. They kept innovating there. It was nothing new. It was still a digital music player with different storage. But I would argue the value of that was the interface device. Zune required that you had to learn more to be able to interface with it properly. I think back to one of the first smart devices I had that was close to a smartphone. You may have mentioned this, Eric, or alluded to it. There was this thing, you know, in the age of BlackBerry, about that same time, a little bit before that, was the Palm Pilot era. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, personal digital assistants were coming along. By the way, Apple tried to go into that space and failed with this thing called a Newton at one point.
Yeah.
But you know, the personal digital assistant, well, I remember when Palm Pilots were coming along. Well, then there was the Dazzle, and Trio did this, put a Palm Pilot in a phone. So it was like almost your first version of an early smartphone, in the sense that your calendar and contacts and phone were all sort of tied together. It guess it sort of texted, you know. There was a company called Nokia. Remember Nokia? They were the ones who were big in texting way back in the day, in terms of how that came from Scandinavia. But I go to say, I had a Windows CE device, if you know what a Windows CE device is. And yeah. I was in that ecosystem for a couple of years when that ecosystem existed. Windows then went into the smartphone space, sort of, but didn't, and sort of still is, but they're not. You know, that's another interesting little side note there. But whatever ecosystem you were in, this is true not just of Apple, was the ecosystem you were in. For a couple of years there, I was in a Windows CE system. And so I was going to, if you were in a Palm Pilot, so, you know, whatever you're introduced to and whatever you know becomes what's there, which is to me what's interesting about, I don't know what's coming next, but something's coming next and it's going to capture some market share. And once it captures that market share, everybody else is going to have to fight to get that market share from them. I use ton, and I still do to some degree, because I play around with a little more, but my guess is what, 95% of the world when they do a web search goes Google? Is that probably a fair guess? Maybe that's low. I don't know. But I can remember back in the day when AltaVista, Yahoo, Metacrawler, which was an aggregator of a whole bunch of web, you know, Lycos, I probably can't even name all the search engines that Jeeves, asked you, all these search engines that existed, that have gone away because Google came along and did it better. Somebody's going to come along here better, either it's Apple or somebody else, and do something new better. And that's going to be the thing we'd be talking about 5 years from now.
All right, Don, while you're talking, I did a Google search for what the global market share of search engines is. And it's been pretty reliable over the last 10 years or so, that Google's between about 86 and 90%. Of the searches, and the last statistics were June, and it was Google 87.7%, Bing 5.5%, Yahoo 2.7%. So your estimate was spot on.
Well, and even think about how that morphs globally. Since I work for a company that's based in Scandinavia, I know that when they go and do their Google searches, it works a little differently than our Google searches do here. So even there's the flavor of that. But you know, wow, you want to talk about ubiquitous? That's the reason it's a verb.
Yep.
And that's one of the reasons, actually, the only when the question was posed, I thought it might not be only because of a certain very large country that I know has had a very interesting relationship with Google in terms of what they'll allow and what they won't. Yep. And Google has really played ball with them.
To continue to have market share, even though it's not the market share they want, desire. Yeah, I really hate when Liechtenstein does that to a big corporation. that really bothers me a lot. All right.
Monaco, just gotta hate it when Monaco does that.
Yeah. Luxembourg, you know, those big populous nations.
Titans. Yeah. Yeah,
that are fighting against what's out there. All right. Guys, I don't know if we've come to any conclusions, but I think we've had a fascinating discussion, and I think our listeners will probably appreciate, if nothing else, the nostalgia aspects of things they've been reminded, but also thinking it through. So I'm going to ask the question I did last time, but being careful to clarify it because I didn't ask it clearly before. Can I try to do this on every version of the room where it happened, which is, so is this the garage and what came out of the garage in 1976, whether there really was a garage or not? We'll just use that as the mythical story of Apple. And you only have to choose one here. In fact, I only want you to choose one. High note, low note, footnote. I'll let whoever wants to go first go first.
I'll do the high note. I think the high note for me with all of this is that it was a big step to bringing computing technology to the masses.
I'll do low note. Now we're in a day where our data is all kept by these giant big companies. Now we're all social media and all these things that are probably not the greatest. And I'm guessing what any smartphone's made of isn't exactly the best for our health. I'm guessing it's not exactly made of apples and carrots.
Even if it's an Apple device, that's even a good point, buddy.
That may be a new use for an Apple device. That might be something useful out of it. I can compost it. Maybe grow some decent tomatoes. Low note, because it was a founding of a cult that thinks you're an idiot.
But not that Chris has strong opinions about this. That's what's important.
I realize they say nobody's ever gone broke thinking the average American consumer is an idiot. But my God, I'm giving you my money and you think I'm an idiot. You just spoon feed me, and don't worry about what's behind that curtain. Just take this.
Well, and not only that, but they altered the business model, which I guess to me is in a lot of ways the thing that I view as being a high note and a low note for them. None of us, for the most part, pay for our smartphones out of pocket for their full amount. If we did, we would not buy them because they're an absurdly expensive product, probably relative to the value that we derive from them. Most of us, do our cellular carriers have the option just a little bit more each month, you can upgrade to the latest thing and they continue to be on an upgrade cycle. So you're more or less, ironically, Eric, gets back to the old days of Bell. You're sort of leasing that device anyway at the end of the day before it's all said and done. And that's been really smart because, you know, the cost of an iPhone or cost of an upper end Samsung or some of the newer things there are in the, it's four digits. Or at least low four digits in most instances, and they've managed to Chris's point, hook the population into needing the latest and greatest version of this because I needed to do that one thing that it couldn't do last year, which is always a part of that. And so I think that to me is both the high note and the low note. You know, iTunes exists as a subscription service because it exists as a subscription service. It changed music. You know, before that, now part of it was in response to Napster and, you know, some piracy and other things that were going on there. But you talk to anybody that's in the music business now, and they will tell you the music business is not what it was 20 years ago. And part of the reason for that is digital music. And a big part of that is iTunes. You know, nobody's buying albums. People are buying singles now at 99 cents a pop or they're paying a monthly subscription to a Spotify premium or something like that, or YouTube premium so that they can actually just go and search for the songs and not have an ad pop up every time they turn around. The model has been changed, and like it or not, Apple changed that model for in a lot of ways, both on the device side and on the actual delivery side. And, you know, back to Brody's point, you know, keep up the fight, Liechtenstein, Luxembourg, and Mauritania, just to throw out another small nation there. But if you're not paying for the product, I read this a couple of years ago, and I believe it's true. If you're not paying for the product, understand you are the product. Because whatever you're getting for free, nothing's for free, which means that they're using your information. The fact that you're getting it for free means your information is going to somebody else who is paying for that. So if you're not paying for the product, understand you are the product.
So, you're here.
Can I give just one other kind of interpretation of that?
Sure.
In your surfing, you still see the same amount of ads, whether they're targeted to you or not. And I remember a couple of years ago, you know, and this is something that at some point, Brody, you will probably be telling people about this and sounding old. Certain cable TV channels owned certain movies, and you watched that movie only on that channel, and they'd rerun it every now and then, and I could never figure out why, but at one point, Lifetime owned the rights to air Goodfellas. So if you wanted to watch Goodfellas, you were flipping through the channels and you wound up sitting there on Lifetime watching Goodfellas. The thing is, the ads you saw on Lifetime were not targeted to people who are flipping around on a Sunday afternoon and watch Goodfellas. So you're still seeing the same amount of ads, though they're just more appropriate to you.
Yeah. The thing that popped into my head there when you said Lifetime, because it took me a second to connect, it almost like the Hallmark Channel owning The Godfather kind of thing. It seems like a really weird combination of things to be a really weird combination. But
family stories. It's all about family stories.
And I'm trying to figure out how they make the parts of The Godfather were set around Christmas, so that's how Hallmark would make it work as a Christmas movie. Now that I think about it, you know, it's about as much of a Christmas movie as Home Alone, you know, is a Christmas is a quote unquote, or Die Hard is a Christmas movie.
I am putting yes, I want to see Hallmark own Die Hard and air it as a Christmas movie.
Die Hard is a Christmas movie. In fact, Die Hard is the best Christmas movie. I watch it every Christmas.
Yes.
Oh,
that actually made me, interestingly enough, that made me more unpopular with my in-laws, trying to get their like 3 and 4 year old daughters to watch Die Hard as a Christmas movie than did rooting against the Cowboys at Thanksgiving.
Oh, I 3 or 4, maybe that's a little, we'll just say that's earlier than I would ordinarily recommend that.
Oh, and I go back far enough that I remember Bruce Willis before he was Bruce Willis of Die Hard fame. So that makes me feel old too. I remember when he was the balding guy on a TV show by ABC in the late 80s, but we won't go there. All right, guys, I really do appreciate your time. Again, I hope our listeners have enjoyed this, whatever this was, because we're still finding our voice here on The Room Where It Happens. But I think we did talk about the things we need to talk about, because we wouldn't have gone on for the hour and a half or so we've probably gone on about Apple if Apple wasn't influential. That's the point. What happened in that garage mattered for better or for worse, or else we wouldn't have had this much nostalgia and other stuff to talk about and how it's morphed business. And I think it proves the point when maybe we didn't actually have a direct point or direct linear way of thinking about it. We proved the point by the fact that we had so many different things to talk about, and the popcorning that happens when you go down those various things in terms of how you mentally connect stuff. So I appreciate Chris and Eric and Brody. I'm glad you could join us for this. Good day. I know we'll have you back. And all three of these guys also spend a little time on a little podcast thing that my daughter and I founded called A Fork in Time. So if you haven't listened to A Fork in Time and you just found yourself to The Room Where It Happens here, there'll be some links in the show notes for you to find that thing and find some of the places that Chris and Eric have been. Eric, I was reminded this week when I actually saw something about polio as a vaccine, remembering our first episode together where we talked about that. So
sure.
everything connects back around. And so I encourage you to go back if you haven't listened to some of the older A Fork in Times or even newer ones that feature Chris and Eric and Brody. Please do that, because they're some of my favorite episodes as well. I always do this one last time around. Anybody got something they're just dying to say before we sign it off? All right. That's easy enough. All right, guys, appreciate your time. Appreciate you as listeners joining us. And stay tuned after this next break, and you'll hear what room number 3 is going to be.
Alexis and Don taking just a quick break from the podcast here. Normally, this is where we would have an ad or a mention. I think that's the inside term that we're supposed, a brand mention is what they're called, at least on the website when we're loading an episode. But today I'm just going to directly appeal for one of the other ways that you can help the podcast, where you may not get as much directly back in return as we do from the others, but still something that's important. So, Lex, what is Patreon?
So Patreon is a platform where actually you can go and support the podcast that you love, including A Fork in Time.
Yeah, and it's not just podcast there. Patreon is probably the number one platform for artists and folks who have various things to be supported on. So podcasts frequently are there, but it can be YouTube channels, it can be the other things that are there. But basically it's your opportunity to become a subscriber or a patron, hence Patreon, for the show. So here at A Fork in Time, We do have a few patrons, and we appreciate them. It doesn't cost a tremendous amount of money to put on a podcast, but it does cost money. And so over time, one of the ways that you can help us defray the cost of the podcast, we've been able to use some of the money to upgrade the equipment that we use. Hopefully you notice that from time to time, is actually by supporting us on Patreon. So Alexis, how does someone find how to support us on Patreon?
Just go to the link in the show notes. You'll see a Patreon link and click on that and you'll get all set up.
Yeah, the other place you can go is actually to our website, which is www.aforkintimepodcast.com. There's a Patreon link there, as well as other non-monetary ways that you can support the show. Alexis and I have said this a number of times. We did not start a podcast to retire on. It's not that lucrative, particularly not a niche podcast about alternate history. But still, there are costs in doing that. So if you can help us out, either through financial or non-financial means, we certainly would appreciate it. And we appreciate, again, the fact that we have built a global audience of what we think of as being our little community. And so we invite you to be part of that. Anything else you want to say about that, Lex?
Just thank you.
Thank you. We appreciate it. Welcome back to the room where it happened. Thanks for sticking with us. Hope you enjoyed our episode here, room number 2, as we explored a little bit of the impact of Apple, computers, and other things Apple. On our technology history of the last 40 years, as we sort of wandered through a combination of nostalgia and impacts. Wanted to introduce what's going to be our topic for room number 3, which will be the September of 2021 episode. And when I tell you where that room is, it's room 301, Emma Booker Elementary in Sarasota, Florida. For some of you, you may immediately be able to make the connection, but for others of you, that might not be incredibly intuitive right off the bat. But as soon as I tell you the date that we're going to be focusing on that room, you'll immediately know what our topic for room number 3 is going to be about. And the date is September 11th of 2001. So as we come up here on the 20th anniversary of the events of 9/11, we thought this would be a good time to have the crew gather together and talk about the impacts of that day and what has happened subsequent to that day. And so we want to do a respectful retrospective of what happened on that day and what's happened since, but also how the world was changed and maybe how it's not been changed since September 11th. And so we invite you, as always, to be part of what we do here on The Room Where It Happened. One of the best ways that you can do that is if you go to the website for our parent company, our parent organization, which is www.aforkintimepodcast.com. The Room Where It Happened is the second podcast in the A Fork in Time podcast, if you will, quote-unquote network. That's really stretching a lot of things there. But you will find our forums there on the website. There'll be a link in the show notes as well. And you have a chance to post your thoughts and your ideas. If you'd like to be part of that episode, not too late to get joining on that. We'll be recording it in the early part of September of 2021. So again, room number 3 is going to be focused on a classroom in Sarasota, Florida. And the date is September 11th, 2001. We hope that you join us, and we hope that you engage with us between now and then so that when you do join us for that episode, some of what you've put as far as input and suggestions finds its way there. Once again, we appreciate your time. We appreciate you joining us here on The Room Where It Happened as we continue to grow this new part of our podcast family. Invite you to share the word. I invite you to visit our website again, www.aforkintimepodcast.com, where you can find out other information about this podcast, as well as how to support and do other things that support this podcast, as well as A Fork in Time. Thanks for joining us, and we hope to have you back next time. Thanks.